So I will do my best in sharing with you my old and new news about the nanoconic crisis. And we can start just looking at the Earth's biological system that are continuously evolving and adapting to global changes. But unfortunately, the changes that we are facing in the Anthropocene are so extreme and so rabid that it's really difficult to disentangle the causes and consequences of such global changes. In fact, industrialization has caused a really accelerated rising of CO2 at rates that have no precedented cases in the Earth's history. So if we look, where are we now relative to pre-industrial times, we know that today the global average temperature has increased by 1 degree Celsius, that the carbon dioxide has raised from around 280 to over 400, and that there has been a rise in sea level, a decrease in biomass, and a decrease in biodiversity. Projections into the future at the end of this century or in the 10,000 years from now are even worse, with a further increase in CO2, a huge increase in warming, an increase in sea level rises, biomass, but a major decrease in biodiversity. And if we want to understand the changes in our planet, we have to look at the oceans, because it is the oldest and the largest ecosystem on Earth. And the Anthropocene ocean is already experiencing, in addition to global warming and some ocean acidification, also some failure in oxygen content, not only on coastal areas that have already become hypoxic, but also in several open ocean settings. So the projections for the future ocean is a very warm ocean, and with oxygen depletion, a major drop in pH, and a drop in productivity. And if we change all these oceanographic parameters, for sure we change the entire biosphere in the oceans. Especially, we change probably the proportion between the primary producer groups that control the entire ecosystem dynamics. And in fact, there are major concerns that are addressed to the possibility that biodiversity loss will be very soon very high, perhaps with an extinction of almost 15% of the known species. So let's use our coccolithophorids. We know that they live everywhere in the photic zone in the oceans, from the equator to the polar regions, from coastal areas to the open ocean. They reproduce, they produce coccoliths and coccosphere, and after they die, they sink through the water column. And if the seafloor is shallower than the calcite compensation depth, then these tiny calcite particles accumulate to form coccoliths or nanofossil oozes with some foraminiferal inside. So we have the entire ocean floor, or large part of the ocean floor, that we can use to understand what is changing through time and through latitude. We are very lucky because our coccolithophorids have a very long evolutionary history. The coccolithogenesis appeared in the Triassic, and there was a major speciation and dispersion of coccolithophores through the Jurassic Cretaceous, and then again through the Cenozoic. And so we can use all this beautiful outcrop with the marine sections made of nanofossils, like the white chalk in the southern coast of England, or we can use hundreds of cores recovered from all the oceans. So we might understand our future if we take advantage of the geological record. And if we compare the mid-Cretaceous, some 100 million years ago, to these far future projections, we see that in the mid-Cretaceous, there were essentially the same conditions as projected for 10,000 years from now, with the only exception of biodiversity, which was very high still in the mid-Cretaceous. And why the Cretaceous had such a high CO2 content with reconstruction based on different proxies? Probably during the mid-Cretaceous, atmospheric CO2 was as high as around 2000 ppm. And we know that it was really a super greenhouse climate at that time. And so if we compare the mid-Cretaceous to the today's situation, we see that back in the middle of the Cretaceous, there were no polar caps at the poles, and everything was much warmer, as for instance testified by findings of Champosaurus, which is like a crocodile or turtles or leaves of the breadfruit trees in the Arctic Canadian, or if we use biomarkers recovered in cores taken at the North Pole, these biomarkers indicate paleo temperatures at the North Pole of some 15 degrees Celsius. So really a super greenhouse. And indeed, if we look at the long history of climate change through the Phanerozoic, the mid-Cretaceous is up here. It was a super greenhouse, a hothouse climate, even much warmer than the early Eocene climatic optimum. And this was also the time of oceanic anoxic event. And we can take advantage of the geological record of oceanic anoxic events because they are Earth system natural experiments that we can investigate to understand the processes associated with greenhouse gases and pollutants, to measure the climate change and ocean fertilization, but also some ocean acidification, the biodiversity, and evolutionary trends. And here we have two of the most famous examples, the Bonarelli level, the sedimentary expression of oceanic anoxic event 2 of latest Cenomanian age, and the Selle level, which is the sedimentary expression of oceanic anoxic event 1A of early Aptian age. And so how resilient were calcareous nanoplankton through these OAs? Of course, the resilience is the ability of an ecosystem to continue functioning despite perturbations. And so ecosystems are resilient if they survive and can adapt to severe perturbations. On the other hand, we have a very stable environment or ecosystem that can survive, I mean, in which population can survive only if the conditions remain very constant. And somehow resilience and stability are inversely correlated. So if an ecosystem is highly stable, it will show low resilience. If the ecosystem is very unstable, it will probably show high resilience to perturbations. So let's have a look at the early Aptian OA1A. I had no idea at the beginning of the type of perturbation and the type of response of calcareous nanoplankton. Was it a resilient? How resilient? How were the thresholds or tipping points? Let's have a look. If we go back to the mid-Cretaceous, the trigger of this very strange climate and very strange oceans, a lot of CO2, was the formation of the Ontong-Java Plateau Large Igneous Province, which is summarized here by this huge jump in the production of oceanic basalts suddenly around 120 million years ago. And this was exactly the age of the onset of OA1A. Here you can see the extension of this super volcano, submarine subvolcano. It was a huge plateau that introduced in the ocean atmosphere system probably up to 2000 ppm and caused a super greenhouse climate. And it's very clear that the world on the ocean was very different before or after the superplume. Before the superplume event, the normal sediment was this white ooze. Now it's a white limestone. And then suddenly there was a change to a black shale interval. And if we look into these white limestones, this Maiolica limestone, very common through the Tethys, but also in the Atlantic Ocean, you see that they are, or they were, nanoconites. All these are nanoconites. These are pieces of limestones just photographed at the SEN. And this was the case through the Beriasian, Valanginian, Autorivian, Barremian. And I want to share with you this picture, nanoconids, or the nanoconid ocean waiting for the superplume. And this is a picture of a thin section with a rosette of Nanoconus taimani. So it was so abundant that you can find, let's say, coccosphere or rosette of taimani, one attached to the other. But it was not only a Tethian affair, so this was not restricting to the Tethys Ocean. You see exactly the same thing in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. These are nanoconid limestone changing into Vatsnauaria or coccolith black shales. And even in the North Sea area, you go from a nanoconid world in the Barremian into a non-nanoconid world during OA1A. But let's have a look at the quantities. In these schemes, these are a type of absolute abundances. So these are real numbers of nanoconids in 1 square millimeter of thin sections. And you can see the black ones are the narrow canal nanoconids, the yellow, the wide canal nanoconids. And if we go back into the late Barremian, you see that there was a first decline in abundance down here, then a shift from a dominant narrow canal to more abundant wide canal nanoconids, and then the final collapse named the nanoconic crisis before the onset of OA1A. This is the Tethys. This is site 463, so in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And if we look in detail at the beginning of anoxia, of oceanic anoxic event 1A, which is the green rectangle here, we see that everywhere the nanoconid crisis level definitely precedes the beginning of anoxia. And associated to the nanoconic crisis, there is also a major drop in general abundance of coccoliths, or all the nanofossil, of course, a decrease in the carbonate content, diversity fluctuates. So there is first a drop, then a rise, then a drop. So it was a very long event, more than 1 million years in total. If we use osmium isotopes, we see that the nanochronic crisis level coincides with evidence of the early phase of Ontong-Java Plateau volcanism, this decrease here. Then in the Tessian area, there is evidence for a weathering spike and then the massive phase of construction of these super volcanoes in the Pacific Ocean. So then, if we go back to the Nanoconic decline, the osmium isotopes are showing an earlier volcanic phase, probably of the Manihiki Plateau in the same region. And then the Nanoconic crisis correlates with the early volcanic phase for Ontong-Java. And then the massive phase is after the onset of OA1A. And OA1A essentially finishes where we have no more evidence of volcanic phase for Ontong-Java. More recently, we found that in this early phase, inside this negative spike of the Delta C13 anomaly, there is three different species are showing dwarfisms. So they both constans, rotatorius and erectus, they become really very, very small in size, while Vatsnauria baronesiae shows some malformation, or what we interpret as malformation, evidenced by a much stronger ellipticity and some asymmetry. And coccolid dwarfism was documented not only in the Thetis and Pacific Ocean, but also in the boreal realm. So it's not a regional effect, but it's really a global change in coccolid production, for especially for Biscutum constans. If we go back to this picture with the nanoconic decline, so change in abundance and the nanoconic crisis, and we look at the evolution, it is very interesting that through this entire interval, there are no extinctions at all. Zero extinctions of any nanofossil species. Conversely, there are new originations of different species or subspecies, both as far as nanoliths and coccoliths are concerned. So some groups of calcareous nanoplankton really got in trouble, and especially the nanoconids, but other coccolithophorid species could take advantage or could survive producing new types of coccoliths and nanoliths. Let's go back to the very detailed beginning. These are just a centimeter, okay, of OAE1A, the base of anoxia. So the nanoconic crisis level is down here, and it is probably related to an early acidification event. We have no other evidence for increased fertility down here, for instance. Then, where you see this nodular limestone, there is a biocalcification minimum. So the really nanoconids go almost down to zero, but an increase of the fertility-related taxa. So I think at this level, we have an increase in fertilization and acidification along with global warming. And when anoxia started, we have a further increase in fertility-related taxa and the real biocalcification crisis. So minimum calcification for calcareous nanoplankton. Dwarfism and malformation starts a little bit later at least level and continue through this interval. So I think if we take the OAE1A as a deep perturbation, I think that the nanoconic decline are telling us that there was an earlier perturbation, perhaps this Manihiki Plateau volcanism, that was shifting our system, which are our coccolithophorid, but they were able to fluctuate in this cap without really changing state. But the tipping point or the threshold reached by the ecosystem when the Ontong-Java Plateau started to erupt was so high that the nanoconids experienced this major crisis, no extinctions though, and the entire ecosystem changed to a new state. But I think that also when OAE was over and volcanism was over, we find assemblages which are even a little bit different from assemblages within OAE1A. So perhaps the end of this major perturbation was itself a threshold to shift the system to another new ecosystem state. So if we take this example to look into our future, I think this was the level of pre-industrial revolution times, very stable environment. And then today in the Anthropocene, we are here with warming, fertilization, acidification. And this picture is telling us that our future is black. So anoxia, changes in phytoplankton and biocalcification crisis. So a major change in primary productivity in the oceans. But let's stay optimistic. We study the geological record and learn, and I hope that we will be able to take advantage and learn to behave better than what we have done so far. Thank you.